In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you very much, Mark. I had the opportunity and privilege to be with these kids last weekend. We were at the Holiday Inn. Tom Scarella was here. And so I said, let's get as many adults in to hear Tom as we can. And so I had a blast with the kids. And we played and talked and played, and we just had a blast. I want to encourage you, if you've never been in with kids, to get in there. Because they're amazing. Aren't you, Gabe? Like, aren't you incredible? Yeah, just amazing. So, yeah, just take it from him. So, I'm not kidding you. These kids are unbelievable. You have some of the most amazing kids I've ever met. And they love Jesus. They love their parents. We talked about honoring God last week. Some of you parents who know me and who have a child, I took a picture of your child on their knees praying for you last week. I just need to know how to get in touch with you to send it to you. So if you just send me a message by Facebook or something like that, and I'll send you that picture because it's pretty special. And if you want to come in and you'd like to give them a snack, if you want to come in and lead a game, if you want to come in and tell a story about what God has done in your life, please speak with Andrea. Okay, and there may be other people you can speak with, Mark and others, but please don't miss that opportunity to love those kids. Folks, a friend of mine is here today. He's right in the back corner there. Right, Dave? Dave was one of the leaders of a couple churches that I was pastor of here in Sarnia, and he was one of the elders and leaders and did a phenomenal job working and representing God on the boards that he was and in the church and just leading and loving people. And one of the things that's very unique about Dave that's amazing among the body of Christ is this. A lot of people have a word of knowledge, but very few people have the spiritual gift of knowledge. And David has it. And I rely on David in the preparation of messages and the understanding of the Word of God because I can go to him. He memorizes God's Word in volumes. I don't know how he does it, but he does it, and God has led him to do it. And that's what somebody who has the gift of knowledge does. They just get in the Word and meditate on the Word and soak in the Word and memorize it. I'm going to ask him to come next week and share some of where we're going next week through the memorized Word. And so don't miss that. Yes?
Mark, the kids can go to kids ministry.
Kids, head out. And Kurt, come on up. Kids, and then Kurt's heading out with the kids today, aren't you?
Yes.
Thanks for doing that. You do a few things. You wear a few hats. One of the things that you wear is be an adventurist.
Yes.
I got to visit your office this week. I really appreciate the opportunity and the invite to your office. And so that meant I got to get to know Kurt and get to know him right in his setting. So if anybody will give me that opportunity, I'd love to come to your office or come to your business or home or wherever and get to know you and spend time with you. But Kurt, you also lead a ministry on Friday night. Why in the world do you do that and what is happening there?
So the Friday night ministry that we're doing right now is a youth and young adult ministry. It is kind of to give kids and young adults an opportunity rather than going out and being part of the world Friday nights and all the stuff that you can get into trouble doing Friday nights. Give them a place to go and just experience the Lord.
So where do you meet?
We meet at the Gathering Place Church in here in Sarnia. It's 756 Maxwell Street, and we meet at 8 p.m. on Friday nights.
And what happened?
So we usually what we do, it's a little different every week, but usually we have a little bit of worship at the beginning, a little bit of prayer. One of the leaders there will share a quick word or something, and we'll kind of go off of that and just experience fellowship together.
Lastly, what's your prayer or dream? You mentioned a teeny bit. What's your prayer and dream for these kids, these young adults who come on Friday nights?
I would say my prayer and dream for these youth young adults are probably to, like I said before, come out of those, you know, traditional Friday night activities and then, you know, have a safe place to be and to be taught the Word of God, but then also to go back into the community and encourage other young individuals and just be a light in our community.
I understand it's hard for people to get in and out of your office without you telling them stories and telling them about Jesus. Is that really true?
For sure.
All right. Go see him. Thank you very much, Kurt. Have fun. Will you pray for him? Raise your hand. And you don't need to do this. It's just a request. Would you raise your hand if you will pray for Kurt on these Friday nights as he leads? Okay. And will you contact him and let him know that you'll pray for him? Because it's a challenging evening. There are things that come up over the course of the evening, aren't there, that are over anybody's head, and God has to work. And God is working through him and the other leaders in that. And if you want to join them for any reason, you want to bring, just like kids, you want to bring a snack, you want to bring a word, you want to bring a story, you want to help Kurt, speak to him, will you? This week, we're headed in the time we have, and no, I won't be speeding. There's no way. But the anniversary, it's my mom and dad's 68th wedding anniversary, and they have loved each other and just sought to outdo each other in love every single day, and they really do. They're a couple that loves Jesus, that gave their life to Jesus. My mom gave her life to Christ first, then said Carl, my dad's name, said, Carl, if you want to date me, you got to come and know the Jesus I know. And you got to not mess around whatsoever. I mean, she laid down the law. And it was really cute. And they have been partners and friends and ministry people. And they have been great parents and grandparents and great-grandparents. And I just love them. And I can't wait to celebrate with them. Myself and my sisters, there's about 40 of us. And it starts at 1. I'll be late. That's okay. They know. But I wanted to be here with you this morning. And there's a lot happening here at the church. And as I came in this morning, some people are excited and saying about things that are going on. And we need to pray. Don't wait for what God is doing and wants to do, because Jesus is building this church. Amen. This is an incredibly special church. And God is working in and through people's lives. One of the things that somebody mentioned online was that I would be speaking on spiritual warfare. Did anybody see that?
Yeah.
And that's good. Thanks for letting me know. No, I'm just kidding. Where we were headed and have been headed and will be in the weeks ahead are talking about the importance of God's Word and being the church. And so the next weeks after this week will be a serious look at spiritual gifts and where we function in the body of Christ. So each and every one of you before the end of October will know and understand your spiritual gift. If not, I'll meet with you personally to help you. But I would like everybody to know, because it says in God's Word that if you understand and know your spiritual gift, the body of Christ is what? Is built up. And people grow. And needs are met. And if we're operating just without this Holy Spirit, there's some other spirit. And there isn't the building up. And the Spirit of God isn't in it. And miracles don't happen. And lives aren't changed. And Jesus isn't glorified. Because why? Because spiritual gifts are how we serve each other and how we love each other and how we care for each other. So we'll be doing that next week. But one of the things that was mentioned is that we would be focusing and taking a look at spiritual warfare. I may not look at spiritual warfare from the perspective of mental health or anything like that. At least here in the messages, I could handle that a little more privately. But I also, as a counselor, pass that off to the psychiatrists and the experts in that area, because it gets complex, right? Mm-hmm. But here today, I want to look at God's Word. And there's a verse in Matthew, and I think, yes, here it is. Can you read that together with me, if you can see that? It says, Jesus said to him. Here we go, we'll start over. Jesus said to him, away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. And James, you mentioned a verse back there about families. As for me, what was that verse?
Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and be baptized, and you shall be saved, you and your house.
You and your house. I want to share with you today that the number one way that spiritual warfare comes into your and my house is right through our front door. Spiritual warfare happens in our home. Is anybody single here? You're still attached to a family, so you do not get a pass today whatsoever. Every single one of you is from a family. Every single one of you is attached to a family. Every single one of you was born into a family. Now, some of those families you'll see today, and I'm going to talk about it quite openly, some of those families had challenges. And some of those families were amazing. And some of those families were somewhere in the middle. So I want you to place yourself where you were. But the enemy, when he comes, and Jesus says, what do you say to the enemy? What did Jesus say?
Away from me, Satan.
As simple as that. We make it complex. And we think, oh, I've got to have this whole package of insight and knowledge and wisdom about how to get the devil out of my life. Jesus said one more time. He said what?
Away from me, Satan.
Away from me. And then what did Jesus bring in? What did Jesus introduce? What was it?
Worship.
Worship. There's a really cool thing in Ephesians chapter 5:18. It says, don't be foolish about the will of God, but know the will of God. And he said, the will of God is being filled with the Spirit. And he says, not being drunk with what?
Wine.
Because wine gets in your hands, gets in your feet, gets in your eyes, gets in your mouth, gets everywhere, and it affects you when you're drunk. And so God says, don't go there, be filled with the Spirit. And when you're filled with the Spirit, it gets in your eyes. You see the right things. It gets in your hand, in your hands, and you touch the right things. It gets in your feet, and it goes the right direction. It gets in your heart, and your heart is on things that God values. And then it says, here's the point. It says right after that, the person who's filled with the Spirit of God, Ephesians 5:18, it goes to 19 and 20. It says that person speaks to one another in what? In psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. And something happens to that person. That person is grateful. So if you ever wonder if somebody's filled with the Spirit, it's easy to tell. That person is like, thank you. Thank you. That person is, their heart is filled with gratitude. Would you like to see your kids filled with the Spirit of God? Stay yeah. grumpy?
Yes.
Yes. Well, you will know if they're saying, thanks, Dad. Thanks, Mom. You know? And if parents are saying thank you to their kids and loving them. And brothers and sisters are thanking each other. And there's music going on. And there's what? There's worshiping. And then out of worship comes service. And so here today, as we look at this, I want this message today to inspire your family. I want you to know that you can say no to the enemy and yes to God right this minute in your family. Families are under attack. Raise your hand if over the course of your marriage or lifetime, your family has ever been under attack. It's pretty much unanimous. So if you wonder ever where the Spirit of God wants to work and wants to do miracles in you, it's your family. If you ever wonder where the enemy creeps in, it's through your front door and in your family. It's in your home. I've said before in other weeks past that Satan wants your who? Satan wants your kids.
Yeah.
Are you going to give them to him?
No.
There's absolutely no way you're going to give Satan your kids. Absolutely no way. And this is for everyone today. And I'm going to be using my notes, which I haven't in the past, but I've written this in the last couple days. And there are 10 things, and so I hope you get out your notes. You use your phone if you want to, and get that notes part in your phone, whether you have an Android or an iPhone or whatever you use. So please take notes today and take notes of these 10 things that are practical ways that God can help you be successful in your home and get victory over the enemy. 10 traits of, and this is what I hope you want, of functional families, of healthy families, of happy families. So are you building your family? Do you have a plan? Do you know how the enemy's creeping in your front door? Do you know your family can get better? Raise your hand if you want your family to improve. Even the kids. Amen. 2019 isn't over. We've got 3 more months. And heaven is cheering you on. God is cheering you on. I'm cheering you on. The leaders of Dunamis are praying for you and your family and cheering you on. Amen. So we're here to help you and your family do better. And if your family's struggling, there are small group leaders in this room that would be happy for you to join their small group. Right, James?
Yes.
Right, Greg? Who else leads a small group here? Anybody else? Vaughn?
Yes.
Yes, amen. Vaughn's going to be sharing at the end of the service. Prepare for him and pray for him. Some exciting things happening. So, husbands and wives, kids, I want you to do this evaluation separately so that when you come to the end of the service and you go home today, do an evaluation and be honest. Nobody lies in church, right? Wouldn't dare. So be honest about this evaluation as to where you are. And you're going to rate yourself, forget about the 1 to 10, rate yourself low, mid, or high. Just keep it simple. So one of the first things that's unique about God, when he introduces families, is he says everybody is unique. Now, the enemy tries to make everybody similar, everybody the same. Our culture is trying to make everybody weirdly similar. But God says in Psalm 139, what? We are fearfully and what?
Wonderfully
made. And Psalm 139 goes on into a beautiful description on how careful it is that God created your kids and you. But why is this? Why is celebrating, and I mean celebrating, uniqueness? Because in our homes, people are different. And sometimes we go, how come I got this weird sister? How come I got this crazy dad, this weird mom, this odd brother, or whoever? Or how come I got this uncle that's just like, he's out there? Or aunt, or grandparents? And it's like, God meant homes to be the training ground for weirdness. Because in that home, God wants you to love each other, but Satan wants you to come in that home and he wants to destroy it. And he wants you to say, hate that mother, hate that father, hate that sister, hate that brother. They are weird. Have nothing to do with them. And so Satan, instead of like God celebrating the uniqueness, Satan destroys and walks in here and says, everybody should be the same. Everybody should be like me. And God says, time out. No way. I want to celebrate how precious everybody is. And I want you in this home to get used to loving each other in, call it the weirdness, the strangeness, the differentness. And God wants you to celebrate it. And so when it comes along and there's something being destroyed in the home as to who each other is and your value, what do you say?
Away from me, Satan.
Away. Away from me, Satan. And then what do you bring in? You worship God, you praise God, and you worship and praise God, and you celebrate how uniquely God created your spouse, your kids, your aunt, your uncle, your cousin, your grandparents, and you show them value. Amen? Don't forget, the family is God's training camp, because God wants you to leave this home. You don't stay in this home. You walk out that door, you open your garage doors, you drive out the driveway, and you go into a world that's a lot weirder than what's going on in your home, right? And God wants us to win those people for Christ and recognize their uniqueness and celebrate them. And yet how many Christians are trying to make people outside the church like them? We need to celebrate people so we don't have to disagree politically. We can appreciate the differences. You get to vote, and you get to vote who you feel God would call you to vote. And those votes are coming up, and they count, and they matter. But God wants you to appreciate. And so where are you on that spectrum? Where were you in your home growing up? Were you celebrated? Was your uniqueness celebrated? And parents, I want to give you a closing tip on this number one. I wish I had done this from day one with my children. I did it, but I did it later. I didn't do it too late, but I did it later than I wish I had it. And that is taking a note of my kids. And just picture one of your children. And what you're going to picture from now on is the moment your children's eyes light up and a smile goes on their face and their eyes open wide, or the moments your children shrivel and look crushed or empty or no energy. And the point of that is God created your children to be fired up and energized and excited about certain things. And that's unique. And so celebrate that uniqueness, but note it and write it down and record it and put it on the fridge. And don't miss it. Not a day in your life should we miss the uniqueness of our children. Celebrate who God created them to be and help them discover who God wants them to be. They don't need to arrive at college and go, I have no clue who I'm going to be and what courses I'm going to take and what I want to become. Our joy and responsibility and privilege as parents is to watch carefully and to say, I see that you love kids. I see that you love art. I see that you love the outdoors. I see you love water. I see you love climbing mountains. Everybody is different. And God created us different. And it's so crazy in our homes when we come for dinner, somebody wants something different. You know, can you imagine just think of your dinners and somebody wants this and somebody wants this and the kids want this. Think of vacations. Somebody wants to go to the mountains. Somebody wants to go to the beach. And somebody wants to go to Disney. And on it goes. Parents can celebrate those things and find those ways to encourage it and appreciate and value that. Let's go to number two. Number two is safe. The question is, did you grow up in a home where you felt safe? Healthy families realize that there are certain kinds of violations in the home that are non-negotiable. That you will not let certain things happen in your home to create a lack of what? Safety. because homes are meant to be safe. And damage is being done to the hearts and souls of children in homes, aren't they? I'm going to go to the worst case scenario. And some people think the worst case scenario is our veterans, and I respect our veterans. One of my friends who was here last week, who you guys love, Ed, who was burned and blown up and all kinds of stuff in Iraq, was here, and I respect him and his service and his sacrifice for our country. But the worst kind of hurt, in my opinion, welcome to disagree with me, but the worst kind of hurt is the hurt that happens in the home to a child who's abused.
That's right.
That's the worst. That's right. And that can never continue, and it must stop. And we need to pray that that never comes in our home. And when it comes in our home, what do we say?
Away from me, Satan.
Away from me, Satan. To that parent, that messed up parent who gets up at 3:30 in the morning and goes in and sexually abuses a child. It happens, doesn't it? And it should never happen. So that's when Satan comes into the home. So how do we make sure it never happens in our home or our neighbors or our kids or our grandkids or our cousins? We need to make what a priority? Safety. We need to make sure that we understand that God respects and values the heart of a child. Remember what the Bible says when it says, if you mess with a child, and this is a paraphrase, a millstone is going to be thrown around your neck, and what's going to happen to you? What is it? You're going to be cast into a sea, not for a sail or a cruise. God and Jesus do not mess around with the treatment of children. They need to be raised in an environment and in a home where it's safe. If you didn't grow up in that home, there's work that needs to be done to encourage you and restore you and help you to forgive that past and work through and come to a place where you're whole and healthy. But whatever you're doing and whatever's happening, let's make sure that as husbands and wives, our homes are safe. It's safe to be yourself. It's safe to say what's on your mind. It's safe to share what's going on in your life. It's safe to be you. That your home is a place of trust and security. And everybody said, welcome, Gavin.
Gavin.
I love you, Gavin. Welcome. Anybody's welcome anytime. It's my fault. They threw me on early today. Actually, I did. But family experts say that there's nothing at all compared to the soul damage kids get when they look at their parents and they don't feel safe. So moms and dads, recommit today to being safe. So how are you doing on this? How are you doing on the first one? How are you doing on safety? Is it high or mid or low? Wherever it is, we say,
away
from you, Satan. And we fill our hearts and our lives with as simple as that. Worship and praise and gratitude and service. The next one, number three, is a common faith. The enemy is coming into our world and our culture in a big way. So the kids are walking into the home and saying, Mom, I don't care what you believe, this is my truth. And so this is what I believe. And I don't care what you believe, and I don't care what you think, and I don't care what your belief is. And some parents even think, oh, I need to raise kids to believe whatever they want. That kids have just an open mind, and they're going to discover the truth in the end. That I can just let their open minds believe whatever they want. So whatever religion comes along, they can just grab it, and they can have it, and they can enjoy it, and they can just, you know, go on their own. Nothing could be more opposed to God when God said, you shall worship no other gods in the Ten Commandments. Number one is you shall worship no other gods except for who?
God.
The predominant character in your home needs to be God. Some of us have ended up in homes, not speaking of myself, but some of us have ended up in homes where we didn't share a common faith with a spouse. And that makes it difficult, doesn't it? And so that's why God says, don't be unequally yoked. Do not connect and marry somebody who doesn't have the same faith you do. And if you do, it's an uphill thing. It's not impossible because you can pray, and we need to pray that spouse would come to Christ. Amen?
Amen.
That's our prayer at that point. But at that point, when God is a part of that home and Satan comes into that home to destroy the faith of those in that home, we say, simple as that. And the believing spouse brings worship into that home. brings, when that believing spout does their devotions, they don't go off and hide in a closet. They bring their Bible out and they lay that right on the kitchen table, wherever it is that they are. And they have devotions, and the kids come by, and the spouse comes by and says, "What are you reading?" And it's like, "You're not going to believe what I saw this morning. Unbelievable. Do you know what God said to me today? Do you know the miracle that happened in my life this week?" And so parents have a common faith and share with their kids what God is doing in their life, and they read the word to them. Do you remember what Deuteronomy chapter 6 says? It says, "Love the Lord your God with what?" Say it with me. "With all your heart and mind and soul and strength. And love your neighbor as yourself." That slips into Matthew 22, 37 and 38. But it says then, he says, "Now what I want you to do with that is I want you to write it on the doorposts. I want you to place it on your heart. I want you to live it." So wherever, how today, contemporary, wherever you drive, you talk about it. Because we drive with our kids. When you go to the sports event, you talk about God from a Christian coaching and an athletic perspective. You raise up great examples of godly men and women who are athletes and share and talk about them. But wherever you go, the most important quality in our homes is celebrating, safety, and thirdly, having a common faith. How do we get to that? It's being on the same page with your spouse. And if you're not on the same page, just make a formal request to your spouse to be on the same page. Communicate and love each other and show respect because we were there respecting one another and celebrating each other. And so as you celebrate one another, you celebrate the common faith that you have. Jesus said, "I'm the way, I'm the truth, I'm the life." He didn't say there's a whole bunch of options. He says there's no way to God but through who? Through Jesus. There's just no way. There's no other way. There's no other God. Number four is respect. Respect, friends, is a learned behavior. Kids don't pop out of the bun and out of the oven and just are respectful, are they? They hit the twos and what happens? What is their word? What's that word? No. You know, it's like, well, that's disrespectful. Don't you realize that? Don't say no to me. But kids don't know. And so they're to be taught respect in the home. And the enemy loves when homes are filled with disrespect. He's like loving it. He's all over that. Because he's like, you fill a home with disrespect, and then there's no love and there's no hope, and then people are despair, and then people don't have any self-worth, value. There's destruction all across the board, isn't there? So begin to ask yourself, what was the home I grew up in? Was there respect? Is there respect in my home? Can I raise the respect in my home today? And don't forget that kids learn respect from mom and dad, and that's why God wants mom and dad to be respectful. And I'm going to say this very, very strong. I have three sisters. I have three daughters. And don't mess with my sisters and don't mess with my daughters and don't mess with my mom. Men need to respect women. If you respect your wife, your kids will respect you. It's a default system, guys. So if men show respect to the woman in the home, you're going to get it because you reap what you sow. You're not going to need to ask for it. You're not going to need to demand it. But because a man shows respect to his wife, and what will happen to the girls in that home? I got great news for you. The home where a man respects his wife, that girl will never go out with a guy who's disrespectful. Will never date and will never marry a guy who's disrespectful to her. Because she'll watch dad pouring in love and respect to his wife. So Romans 13:7 says this. It says, "Give to everyone what you owe them. If you owe them taxes, pay taxes. If revenue, revenue." Then it comes to this. If you owe respect, what do you give?
Respect.
Honor, honor. Last week, the few moments we had with the kids was just to have them write on a balloon the word honor, and we went to the Word of God in the Old Testament and the New Testament, where it says there's one commandment with a promise, and it's what? Honor your mother and father. That's got to be over the head, over the place of your home, where you say, in this home, the only thing we'll do here is honor one another. And then there's, as far as I'm concerned, a little secret for parents. If honor is your number one thing, the only thing, next thing you need to ask of your kids is, don't lie to me. You don't need any other rules, as far as I'm concerned. Because if honor's in the home, that child will come home when they're supposed to. And won't stay out of curfew. That child won't, you know, and you say, don't lie to me, and the parents don't freak out when their kids tell them the truth. There's honor because the parents are honoring the kids in the chaos of their life and teenage years and everything. Just tell me the truth and I'll pray with you and encourage you and help you. But may there be honor in every home. So that's, we're just trying to teach our kids that. And parents, make sure that you're honoring each other. So respect needs to be up there. How are you doing? Is honoring high and respect high in your home? Mid, or is it low? And is there room for improvement? And when respect, we struggle with it, we say to the enemy, don't get tired of that. Don't get tired of saying that with me, because that's what you've got to say. And then we come back and we fill our homes with worship and serving one another. Number 5, responsibility. Healthy families have responsibility. One of the coolest things that God did at creation, if you just go back in time and take this time travel with me. And the moment that God created the world, the first thing he said to Adam and Eve is he said, take care of what? Where were they in? Where did he put them? He planted them in a what? In a garden. And he said, you now have the responsibility to care for this garden. I was at a restaurant yesterday where a mom had a couple of her girls with her working like crazy and taking responsibility, and they did an unbelievable job. It was phenomenal. It was really great. But that's parents who have taught children that chores are important. So parents must teach. Because in the home where Satan reigns, kids do whatever they want. Parents let kids have no responsibility. Parents do it all and figure, I'm going to spoil my kids because I didn't get spoiled. God said, I created you to have responsibility. I created homes to have chores. I created your home to be responsible. And so parents that make their kids responsible bring in Jesus. Parents who let their kids run wild allow Satan to destroy that home. And there's going to be spiritual warfare in that home because their kids are going to be out of control. And as I spoke with one of the employers this week, of one of his employees who has a struggle with somebody in the home, it's because the kids hadn't been working. The kids could do whatever they want. And so then mom can't go to work because she's got to handle the dysfunction of the kids who are creating chaos and won't work and are, you know, it's just a mess. So Genesis 2:15, don't forget that. God put man in the garden to work and take care of it. And the biggest frustration that I'm finding from employers today, and this is not, I think there's a ton of millennials that are incredible, but there's a pile of millennials that have been spoiled. And so they get to work and the boss says, you got to show up for work in the morning. And they're like, what? And then you want me to come tomorrow too? And then they take lunch. And one of the things he has to say is you got to come back after lunch to work, right? Like, yeah, seriously? Like, are you kidding me? Exactly, that's the expression. Right on, thanks for picking that up, Gavin. So we do our kids no favors at all when we don't give them chores and responsibility. And friends, as parents, you will have spiritual warfare like crazy unless you increase the responsibility, because very soon you have, if I may use our worship leader's name, you'll have a Carly who will leave her home and be fully responsible for everything in her life, from the files to the taxes to the responsibility to the rent to the insurances to the everything, to the cooking, the cleaning, and loving somebody else at the same time. Right, Carly? Mm-hmm. So we are preparing our kids to launch. Right? Amen? We're not preparing our kids to stay home for the rest of their lives and stay in our basement.
Yep.
We're preparing our kids to be fully responsible, functional adults. Amen? The enemy will destroy your home unless you do that. And so just say no to the enemy when he comes along and says, spoil, spoil, spoil. Say no. Give responsibility and increase it. And even when kids say, oh, come on, Mom, no way. Yeah. Healthy families stay together and work together. And
pray together.
Yes, and they pray together. And that's the next one almost. The next one is play. One of the most important things about God's creation is He created us and He told us to take time off. And there's the R word, and it stands for what? Rest. So God says rest, and He built in rest to the whole creation. Who took time off on the Sabbath day? Who first took time off? God did. So if God thinks He needs a break, who are you to think that you can work 7 days straight, 24 hours? Some of us think we're superhuman, and so we work, and then what happens when we work like that? We burn out. We blow up. We blow up at people. We blow up inside ourselves because we can't manage life. We can't work 7 days straight. We can't. We must take a break. And one of the things about healthy families is they play together. They throw a frisbee. They play pool. They play ping pong. What else do families do? Anybody else got some suggestions? What do you do as a family to play together? Just yell out one of your things.
Fishing.
Fishing together. That's awesome. What else?
Swimming.
Cars.
Cards.
Cards. Play cards, yes. Yes. I see my mom and dad playing cards. Hey, what you guys doing? Who's winning tonight? What else?
Baseball games.
Baseball games. Any sports. Just enjoying playing, throwing ball. Wiffle ball. You know, until your arm can't throw another one. But what happens when people play? It takes the stress out of life. What does Satan want? Satan wants you stressed out. Satan wants you anxious. Satan wants you afraid. Satan wants you exasperated and exhausted.
That's right.
And so when you get to that point, you say to Satan,
away from me, Satan.
Get out of my life. I'm taking time off. Work hard and play. Matthew 11:28 has a beautiful message. It says, come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you what? I'll give you some play. God, you're going to spend some time in heaven, and we're going to be preoccupied working in heaven just as responsible at the outset of creation. We're going to be scooting through the universe and doing what God created us to do. It's going to be pretty incredible. One of the things we'll be doing, too, is doing a lot of playing and worshiping God. I'm sure of it. Okay. So homes that are filled with these things are healthy homes, and the enemy you want, again, we're not complicating spiritual warfare. Spiritual warfare is as simple as these things, where Satan comes into our home and tries to destroy our homes, where we say no. We will take time off. Here's another one. And we have, next weekend we celebrate what?
Thanksgiving.
Thanksgiving is a tradition. And I hope you have traditions. I hope you have Thanksgiving traditions. And if you don't have a place to go over Thanksgiving, start inviting somebody, or start saying, raise your hand and saying, invite me. I eat turkey, and I love gravy, and I will bring the potatoes, or the sweet potatoes, or I will bring the squash, or I will bring the dessert. But friends, get together and make this a family, and celebrate together. We got to be practical, because coming up to Thanksgiving, and people having nowhere to go, Satan's going to come in and say, well, see?
Yeah.
Do you matter? Let's not let that happen at Dunamis. Let's love each other. Care for each other. But one of the most important things here is Satan comes along and tries to destroy traditions. There was a nation called Israel. Did Israel have any traditions? They had some pretty incredible special traditions, and yet we come and we see that, and we read Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, and all the way through Malachi, and we know the Old Testament, but we miss the cool things they did to celebrate and traditions they had. And so we come into families and we're like, ah, traditions aren't important. Well, traditions help families identify that we're meeting for this reunion this year. My parents' anniversary, special. Everybody's getting together. Cousins, aunts, uncles, kids, you know, siblings. Everybody's coming to celebrate because traditions are important. So don't let Satan convince you that your family doesn't matter, that traditions don't matter. And if you have a family member, it doesn't matter, You can do it with whoever you want. Become a part of somebody else's family's tradition. Start your own.
Golden Star.
Right on. Thanks, James. So, Christmas traditions are coming up. Thanksgiving. No, there's a blessing, and there's a reason, and kids feel a part of a home, and are excited to come home after during college, and excited to come home for things because of traditions. So if you haven't had them, start to incorporate them in whatever way you can. Even if it's one a year, you have that one thing a year you look forward to. The enemy says it doesn't matter, God says it does. Say no to the enemy and worship God. And take a peek at those amazing traditions that some people have in this church, share them together. We've only got three more. Number eight, seek help. One of the things this enemy says is you can do it on your own. One of the things the enemy says is you don't need
anybody.
One of the things the enemy says is you can handle this all by your... You ever heard a two-year-old or a five-year-old? I can do it by my... God created a cool thing in us of dependence to independence, and it's supposed to be. But God, that's, some people think independence is the bullseye. Interdependence is sharing your gifts, being one with each other, being part of a body, part of a family, working together. So the most important thing that God says to you is seek help. Proverbs 15:22 says, plans fail for lack of what? Counsel. But with many advisors, they succeed. Are you the type of person who, when you have a problem, you rush immediately to get help? Or do you sit in your home, in your car, in your office, and struggle, and struggle, and struggle, and struggle, and struggle, and struggle? No victory, no help, no resources, no encouragement, no support, no nothing. When you have a problem, God is the God of the universe, and he has solutions and answers and insight and wisdom. And James chapter 1 verse 5 says, if any man lack wisdom, he should what?
Ask.
So when the enemy comes along and says, you can handle this all by yourself, you say, just stop that nonsense, because we can't. We need our spouse, we need our parents, we need our friends, we need our church. So please, go to a Christian counselor. Come to the leadership of this church. Get help and get it quickly before things go south. Positive things are happening in this church, because since I've been here, I hear people all over the place reaching out and asking for help. That is an unbelievable quality. That means God is going to do great things here, because people are saying, help me. People are saying, I can't do this by myself. People are saying, I need you. I need God. Will you help me find out what God's solution is for this? There's so much help available today. So where's your help factor? Are you a person who rushes for help? Are you in the middle? Or are you a person who does it by yourself? You'll get the solo results the rest of your life unless you're willing to reach out. But Satan will rejoice and be thrilled for you to just sit all by yourself and for things to go south and stay there. God wants you to come alongside him and alongside others, and that's why we have the church. Number nine is open communication. Satan wants to block communication and stop it. He's tried to stop it in the garden between Adam and Eve, tried to get them to blame each other, tried to get them to cut off communication. The beautiful thing about our Heavenly Father is he says, talk to me. Bring things out into the what? Into the light, into the open. Jesus says, I am the what of the world? I'm not the darkness. I'm not to shove things under the ground. People and homes and families are shoving things under the carpet. What happens when you shove things under the carpet in your home? Tell me.
Built.
What happens?
Carpet gets higher.
Carpet gets higher. It's hard to walk and you trip on it. That's great. I never thought of that one. What else happens when you shove things under the carpet?
They just build until they boil over.
It builds and blows up. What?
Hidden.
Things are hidden, and then nobody understands, nobody knows. Nobody knows how to help, nobody knows how to pray, nobody knows how to encourage. And everybody fakes it and pretends, and there's these crazy things that happen. So, do you know how many kids have come to me? Because I started out years ago being a youth pastor in my teens, and then went to college and was, and for years was, and then associate pastor, senior pastor, and so on. But I love kids. And kids would come to me and say, I would say, why can't you tell your parents about this? And they go, I can't. They wouldn't listen. And parents, we need to have homes where our kids will come. But our kids will come when they hear mom and dad talking, or when they hear mom talking to their dad, or mom talking to their grandparents, or mom talking to their friends, and being open. And just say, hey, I'm struggling. I'm hurting. I have no idea. Don't have any solutions. Or this is an employer issue. Or this is a financial issue we've got. Or this is a personal issue. I'm struggling, and I'm struggling with food or weight or exercise. Or I'm struggling with sleep. I just don't get enough sleep. Or I'm struggling with just depression or whatever it is. God wants us to have open communication with each other. May those who run small groups here have a small group that's where there's open communication, where people can be open. May the leadership be blessed here of open communication with each other. May your homes be blessed, because Satan wants to block off the communication. He wants things hidden and covered up, and God wants them exposed. The one thing I love about my God is when I open the Bible and I go from Genesis to Revelation, there's a lot of pretty difficult stories I read there of people who messed up. And God doesn't hide one of them. Brings them all out into the light. And he says, hey, even Noah, who did a great job of building that ark and getting people on it and doing that whole thing, he messed up big time. This guy David that is called the man after God's own heart. Wow, you want to know some of the things that he did? He'll tell you himself. But then he'll come and bring you into Psalm 51, and he said, he'll say to God on his knees, create in me a clean heart, God. And he exposes everything about his sins before God. And he doesn't cover them. Amen? The last one comes from, and James, if you will put this one up for me, 2 Corinthians 4:7. And I put this up because this is one of the most important in the whole list. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show us that this all-surpassing power is from God and not us. In highly functioning homes where Satan is not reigning and ruling, people treasure each other. The husband says, honey, I treasure you. The wife says, honey, thank you. I treasure you too. Or parents said, kids, wow. You know, it's one of the things I used to say to my kids, and it's not original with me, and maybe you said it to yours, but I said to my kids at bedtime, I said, if I could line up all the kids in the world, every single one of them, I would pick you. Because there's nobody like you. What makes family relationships so special and so powerful is when people treasure each other. And you know what the enemy does, though? There's another T word, and it's trash. The enemy makes you feel like trash. He makes people make each other feel like trash. And trashes each other. And demeans and devalues each other in the home. And if you grew up in one of those families, I'm sorry, but you can change it today. You can go to mom and dad if there's any lack of treasuring, and you can say, this has to stop. We need a home that's filled with people who treasure one another. And I'm going to treasure you. And if you don't treasure me, I have to step away from that. You might need to move out. But you need to step away from a person who treats you like trash. You need to set boundaries. You need to stop that kind of stuff. Amen? It can't continue. Because we've got to say to Satan, away from my life, away from my home. I'm not going to fight this. I want to have friends that treat me like I'm a treasure. I want to have relatives that do. I'm going to treat my children like the treasures they really are. I've got a story to conclude, and this wraps it up today. There was a farmer who grew, and I've got some friends around Sarnia here, and they grow a lot of corn. But there was a farmer who grew quality corn. Every single year, he won the award for the best grown corn. One year, a newspaper journalist reporter interviewed him and learned something interesting about how he grew it. The reporter discovered that the farmer had shared a seed of corn with his neighbors. And the reporter asked him, how in the world can you afford to share your best seed corn with your neighbors when they're entering the same corn competition with you every single year? "Why, sir," the farmer said, "didn't you know? The wind picks up the pollen from the ripening corn and swirls it from field to field. If my neighbors happen to grow inferior corn, cross-pollination will steadily degrade the quality of my corn. So if I'm to grow good corn, I must help my neighbors grow good corn." So it is with our lives. If you or I want to live a meaningful, well-adjusted, well-functioning, highly functioning life that gives God glory, the value of that life is the measure in which it touches another life. And if you want to choose to be happy and joyful, you've got to help others find happiness and joy. The welfare of all of us here at Dunamis is bound up with each other. Amen?
Amen.
Let's stand and pray. Mark. Heavenly Father, there's 10 things and there's probably 100 more. But there's a few things, and we ended with treasure. May I treasure my friend Mark and everyone else here in this room as who you created them. Thank you, God, for the privilege of sharing the word at Dunamis today. May our homes fight the enemy away and say no and invite worship and service and the treasuring and respect and honoring into our homes. Amen?
Amen.
Thank you. Have a seat.
They're not really nunchucks, but
so Vaughn's got a story to tell. These are walking sticks, and it's concerning the Brigden Fair this weekend.
Right.
And it's about sharing the good news with people.
Yes.
So Vaughn, tell me about this walking stick and what the beads are for.
Okay. This is represented by the Fellowship of Christian Farmers of Canada, right. And it's a great ministry. They go into communities and present the gospel, and they use these walking sticks, and it's a really simple message. It's salvation message. They have different color beads on these walking sticks. The first one is gold, which represents heaven. Obviously, God's prepared a place for each one of us, and he wants us there. The second bead is dark. It's a black bead, and that represents sin, which separates us from God. And anything that we've done in our past where we know it's not the right thing to do and we do, that's sin and it's displeasing to God. So it created a problem, a divide between us and the Lord. And the third bead is red, which represents Jesus' blood. God sent his son to die on the cross. He provided salvation for us. He redeemed us. And we share that with people, the redemption, the power of the blood, and how Jesus bridged the gap between God and us and brought us back to the Father. The white bead represents purity, which the Bible teaches that when we receive Jesus, he cleanses us from all unrighteousness, that God looks at us as pure. He sees Christ in us. He doesn't see our sin anymore. We're clean. The last bead is green, which represents growth, or go into the world and preach the gospel. And it represents what we become, how we become new creatures in Christ, how we go with it. We're new people. We have a new birth in our lives, and we become new, and we're set free from our past. So it's a really simple message of the gospel. And what we do is we give these walking sticks to anyone that comes into the tent that will listen to that 2-minute message. And I may be butchered it this morning, trying to rush through it, but they will actually give you training. If you will sign a sheet this morning with my wife, your name will be given to the head of this organization. He will contact you through email if you choose that, a phone number, whatever it is you choose. He'll let you know when the Brigden Fair starts. I made mention of Dunamis to him because I know that you have a heart for people. I know that you want to see people get saved. Who here has led somebody to the Lord? That's awesome. A lot of people here. So I know you're soul winners. This is an amazing opportunity because people come into this tent and they come to hear that message. Mm. They know that they're going to hear a message before they get this walking stick as a gift. Mm. So it's really, really, it's a powerful tool. people are praying now that God will send hungry hearts to those tents. So the Holy Spirit's already at work. So he's drawing people to the Brigden Fair. You guys are as close as any other city. So I mentioned it to them, and they said, please get some names. If you don't feel like you've got what it takes to present the gospel that way, you can help in so many different ways. People have the gift of helps. They can help set up the tent. They can make these little staffs and drill a hole in the wood and put the beads on the lace. There's a number of different things that you can do to help this ministry. And there will be a harvest. One of my friends just led 29 people to Christ at the last one, which was just a Saturday. It was at a car show in Chattanooga. That was just him. So there were hundreds of people that came to Jesus. And when I was up at the car show, I saw these people walking around with these sticks. And some of them were brand new believers. So it's really exciting. It's a great ministry, and it's not complicated. It's just the gospel message.
Praise the Lord. So, Vaughn, if somebody wants to, so I go to the Brigden Fair, and there's a booth set up there, right? There's tons of booths all over the place.
Yes.
There's a booth set up.
Yes.
They got these staffs there. I see there's a card on that one.
Yes.
As well, that explains.
Yeah, yeah.
So for me to explain, this is like 2 minutes.
2 minutes.
2 minutes.
And they'll actually give you training prior to starting.
Yeah.
There's a little crash course that they'll run you through. And again, if you don't feel comfortable, they'll have you making these things and drilling holes, putting laces on.
I want to do this in kids' ministry.
Yeah.
That'd be awesome.
Right? That'll be for Sunday. We'll do this in kids' ministry.
Yeah, yeah.
Or if you want to just, hey, I'm available. I'm going to pray for people. I'll come out to the tent. I'll just pray for people. That's okay, too.
And you can invite them to Dunamis because they need a church.
Yeah.
And that's the benefit of this for this church. Not only do you lead somebody to the Lord, you bring them to Dunamis.
That's very cool. So, Vaughn, stick around after church.
Sure, you'll have a piece of paper, and you can
just your email or your phone number.
Whatever you're comfortable with.
And if I can only do an hour, I can just do an hour?
Yeah. There's, I believe there's 3 or 4 days.
Mm.
4 days? Yeah. Mm-hmm. So we'll have the dates and everything, and the president, Sherman Smith, will contact you with all the details.
It's a good program. I like it. Thanks, Vaughn. Thanks for sharing that.
I'll leave one of these here and this at the back.
Awesome. Thanks, Vaughn. We're going to, Carly, do you want to come up? And we're going to spend about another 15 minutes or so of worship to conclude the service this morning.